2017 is almost here. I don't know how you feel about 2017. Multiple things are happening. They're pretty exciting in the life of our church. And let me just give you a couple of updates that we have gone through in 2016 for us as a church. One of them has to do with last weekend. Last weekend, I had a couple, one of the three couples that came and visited with me because I'm doing three weddings this 2017 already set. Dates, reservations, I mean, it's a done deal. Three of them. So that's pretty exciting. You know, closing the year with commitments into marriage. It's always beautiful to see that. Hopefully some of you get the hint. And I'm free a couple of other weekends. So if anybody wants to join the journey of marriage, I'm always up for that challenge. We had multiple people, six of them, on a stage during the summer doing a Q&A interview type of deal during the summer for our missions. So we went to the nations. We empower, we commission people, and they came back and they were interviewed. So that's exciting. During 2016, the challenge that I made or I gave them back when we first talked about this mission endeavors was that for 2017, and this is kind of a heads up to you as a church, for 2017, as much as I would love to interview them again as they go back and serve again to the nations, I told them, I said, for 2017, I love to see you, since, talking about the guys here on the stage, since you are the ones that are failed and are led and are responding to the call, I want you to become the mobilizers of our church. So instead of you going next year, 2017, I want you to take us with you. I want us to be the catalyst for this endeavor. So that's also pretty exciting. So for us as a family, 2016, our oldest graduated from high school. That's a win. She got a job. That's even a better win. So, you know, it's looking really good for us. We are excited. I'm excited of coming into this brand new year. One of the things that I will have to definitely share with you about 2017, this is not on your handouts, but we as evangelicals, we will celebrate 500 years of the Reformation. It was a Catholic monk that 500 years ago launched through the reading of the book of Romans, a journey that transformed the remaining of the world, for that matter, not just history, but the world. And Martin Luther, this coming 2017, we will celebrate half a millennial. This is just an amazing thing. Now, this Reformation, 500 years ago, created a Reformation on a healthy doctrine. What's the opposite of healthy? Unhealthy? Sick? So prior to the Reformation, doctrine was pretty much corrupted, was pretty much abused. I mean, you may want to go back and read a little bit of the things that happened prior to the Reformation in the life of the church. There was no separation of church and state, so it was a very holistic view of how countries and nations and empires were governed through the church and by the church. But again, 500 years ago, there was a split, there was a broken relationship, and that created a movement that brought us into the health of doctrine. Part of that movement had to do with us getting access to the scriptures. Prior to that, there was no access to individuals, to people, to read the scriptures. You were only able to come into gatherings like this, and you have to conform to whatever you were told about the Bible. Now, for us as a church in 2017, what we understand, what we need to do and we need to go, is to experience another Reformation. And the Reformation for us is not going to be doctrinally, because we believe that we have embraced a holistic view of the scriptures, but it has to do with the health of church life. And for that matter, we're going to embrace and we're going to take the book of Ephesians for the next three Sundays, beginning today, just to talk about health in the life of the church. Now, this is extremely important for us when it comes to health in the life of the church, because healthy things, by default, you can talk about the life of the church, healthy churches, healthy families, healthy marriages, healthy individuals, if you're healthy, physically healthy, that creates unity. So one thing that we will not do in 2017 is to strive for unity. I think unity comes out of healthy experiences. So think about marriage. If your family is going through some brokenness and some divisions and some conflict, it's not because you don't like each other. It's not because you have a strong will or what you did in the past and they haven't been forgiven. The issue, it's not us, it's not you. The issue is health. Because here's my argument. I will even say that if you're trying to focus on unity, you're making it about yourself. Because by default, you get to define unity. I don't think we get the privilege to define unity. I think unity is defined by the scriptures, by a God who, the God who is a triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, right? So this triune God that is three persons, and within these three individual personalities or personhoods, they work together, is nothing else but us understanding that if He is our God, if that's the God that we worship, then this unity that He models for us through the triune God, through the Trinity, has to be reflected. Since God is healthy in His relationship with the among Himself, with the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you know, it has to be reflected. So again, for us as a church, we do not strive for unity. When you have a divided church, a divided family, a divided country, it's simply because it's not healthy. Now, here is the challenge for us. And today, as we just went for the last 25 minutes on a stage, diversity for us as a church is an understatement. We are not a bilingual church. We are a dual language church. That's who we are. We hardly ever do bilingual things. Bilingual is like when you're switching from one language to another. So, you know, we just went and worship in English. We had some guys leading some worship songs in Spanish. We don't do that every Sunday, but today was a kind of a different Sunday. And now we get to speak the Word of God, and you're going to read through a language called English. But we just finished another service that was completely in Spanish. So again, because of the diversity of who we are, this is how God created us to be. A healthy church that produces unity, by default, celebrates. Now, what's the opposite of celebration? Anybody knows what I'm talking about? Maybe mourning? Maybe just, you know, that sense of despair and just, again, just a sense of loss. See, when you have an organism that is not healthy, therefore not creating or producing unity, you're going to see diversity as a problem. Meaning that if people don't think like you, behave like you, speak like you, don't look like you, that's a problem. That's a problem for you, for me, when we are unhealthy, when we are divided. So today, what we're going for the next three Sundays is to strive for a healthy church that, again, produces, models unity. And Lord, do we need unity in this country? Mercy. And then celebrates diversity. What does that mean? Well, again, it's not going to get any more homogeneous than what it is today. We have to celebrate. This is reality. This is the United States of America. We are the country that attracts the most diversity probably in the history of humanity. The nations are here. You are here. I'm here. And we're not going anywhere. Are you going anywhere? I'm not. So here we are. This is our church. This is where God places us. We have to figure this out. It's a command. It's the character of the God that we worship, for that matter. So here's how we're going to portray this. We're going to bring in the next three Sundays the understanding that doctrine must stop of being perceived as cognitive exclusively. It has to become a lifestyle. Because here is what I'm dreaming about for the next three Sundays in 2017. Can you imagine a group of men and women, you and I, making decisions through the lenses of what we believed? What a noble idea, right? Think about it. Acting based on what we know of who God is. Most of us, the issue is not that we don't know, it's that we disregard what we know of God, and we still imply our very own preferences. See, one statement that I made earlier, and again, I'm going to make it again, and I'm probably going to get in trouble. I don't know, maybe. Here's my thinking, and please, let me finish the thought before you judge me, okay? We have an 8:30 service that is distinctively unique because of the worship style that we do. And by the way, the young crowd that you saw on a stage, they lead hymns. That is just beyond comprehension for me, okay? Because that includes my kids also. It's just, oh, hymns. Okay, great. I'm glad they're learning those things. Okay, then you get into the second service, which is Spanish music, okay? It has a different flavor, a different kind of a take on that, and that's beautiful. And then we come into this service. Can I just say something very briefly? Again, please do not hear this from judgmentally, but I'm going to say it again. There is no church, there is no organism that can remain and stay together based on personal preferences. As much as I love our worship styles, they need to become means to an end, not the end. What does that mean? That if we were to cancel one of the services for whatever reason, or change the music style, I know you have preferences. I got my own preferences, right? When it comes to worship style. But churches Again, organisms, they do not stay or remain because of personal preferences. So your personal preferences, as important as they are, and they are important. I mean, if you think about dating, that's exactly what attracted to each other. It was your way of thinking. That's why when Areli, when I, you know, dating, and I was like, I'm in. I want this girl. So I like her personal preferences. Now, those personal preferences, if we're not careful, we can potentially make them idols. We start worshiping. So personal preferences, they have to become means to an end, a greater end. We're going to talk about that in just a minute. But here's the point. The point is that doctrine becomes relational, becomes a lifestyle. Truth has to become relational. Because here is what I have said in the past, and I'm going to say it again. If we're going to strive for health, so it produces unity, and it celebrates diversity. See, truth, the Bible doesn't call us to be right. The Bible calls us to be loving. There was a man by the name of Saul of Tarsus that he had the right to get letters from the synagogues. And on chapter 9 of the book of Acts, he was on the road to Damascus to kill men and women because he had the right. So this morning, you having the right or you being right, that is simply means to an end. I don't want you to simply strive for rightness. I want you to embrace the righteous one. How did he become the righteous one? By John 3:16, he loved a broken cosmos, a bunch of people who were enemies of God. So once again, the point in here is that truth is relational. So the more that you know doctrine, the more that you embrace it as a lifestyle. Because the more that you know truth, the more that you improve your relationships. And ultimately, dream with me. Within the next few months, and then obviously 2017, if we can have a church that practices faith and repentance, not simply as a dot on a continuous timeline that will say, well, I had faith, I put my faith in Jesus, and I repented of my sins when I was 17, when I was 14 at a youth camp. I'm glad you did that. Can you imagine that being repetitive all the days of our lives, not for salvation, but in this case, so we can exercise what you see on the screen, Christ-likeness. Can you imagine a generation of men and women that repentance is our daily, instead of looking at brothers and sisters that need to repent, because if you're right, I'm right, and you're wrong, so you need to repent, not me. But you see where we're going with this? So this is where we're going for the next few minutes. Now, Paul, which is, oh man, it's a major character. Apostle Paul, you know, writes 13 of the 27 books of the New Testament. He is very predictable on his writings and his style. What does that mean? That out of the 13 letters, it's very simple to see how the letter is divided right in the middle. And the first part of the letter, which for us right now, we're in chapter 4 of Ephesians, the first three chapters, 1, 2, and 3 of Ephesians, those are the first half of the chapter, and they are focused on the doctrine, on the theology, on the let me tell you, let me teach you how what the problem is. Now, chapter 4 is the second half, and the second half is the so what? Therefore, this is what it means. So the first three chapters that we have no time to read, but you will this afternoon because the Cowboys are not playing. So why would you watch football if the Cowboys are not playing? So read the Bible instead of watching whatever. So first three chapters, they are the in-depth, the theology. We don't have time to read it. But Paul writes this letter because apparently in these churches in Ephesus, they were divided. They were not healthy, and they were not celebrating diversity. Diversity was a problem for them among the church. Jews and Gentiles and skin color and languages and dietary laws and all these things. It was chaos. Then here's another thing that was happening in this time history. Part of the problem is that there was an infiltration of philosophies that had to do with Hellenistic view, Greek philosophies, and it was filtrating the body of Jesus, and it was just splitting things right in the middle, and it was chaotic. And Paul writes. And Paul has a word to say to this generation of men and women in this time in history, which I believe he also has a word for us today. Pray with me. Father, in the name of Jesus, we acknowledge that this is your word, that this is your idea. We're simply communicating what you have told us to communicate. So bless this time in Jesus' name. Amen. Chapter 4, verse 1, here we go. This is how you begin the conversation of health, unity, and diversity. You and I must see ourselves, as Paul began this chapter 4, as a prisoner for the Lord. You will never, I will never be a part of a healthy organism, whether it's your marriage, whether it's your relationship with your in-laws or your parents, if you keep on thinking that you have freedom and you have the right. In Jesus Christ, freedom is exactly the opposite. In Jesus Christ, you have a man that is not figuratively, it's not imagery that he is incarcerated. This is a prison letter. So that means that he is literally chained to a Roman soldier. These are the people, these soldiers are a symbolism, a tangible reality of the abuse into my people, Paul thinks as a Jew. And he is chained to that. And in the context of this incarceration, he, in God, has the freedom to write and to put together all these writings that even today, as we sit and we come into worship, look at the freedom of these writings. We are here 2,000 years ago. Look at how freedom is perceived. And I'm saying this to you because if we're going to be a church of freedom, a church that understands, you know, the concept of health, the concept of unity and the concept of embracing diversity and celebrating diversity, we must begin as a bunch of prisoners. What does that mean? That implies that if you are a prisoner for the Lord, just like Paul, you need to put every single thing that is within you based on who God is. That implies that you, look at me, you, and I know this is going to be so anti-American, and I'm not going to apologize for that, but you have, let me rephrase that, you do have rights. The only right you have is to serve. That's the only right you get. Beyond that, you have no rights. Because see, if you don't see yourself as a prisoner, you're going to engage your current wife or your future husband, and you eventually, life gets crazy. You're going to demand your rights. You're going to say to him, you promised. I asked you before we got married, and here we are. What's up? I talked to your mom prior to our wedding, and she clearly told us that she will never fill in the blank. Now, this is why you're coming to a Baptist church, because you had the preconceived idea of what Baptists are supposed to be and do. And here, everybody tracking on this? You are a prisoner for the Lord, and you don't get to define freedom. See, freedom is the ability to simply choose to do right. And since you and I, we are by default enemies of God, you don't have the ability to do right unless the righteous one empowers you. Is that a fair statement? You have no ability, even if you want to do right unless the righteous one empowers you. So that means that you need to become, and this is how Jesus empowers people, you become a prisoner of and for the Lord. So here is the urgency. I'm urging you. Since you, church, since you, churches in Ephesus, you see yourself as free. You are fighting instead of embracing and celebrating diversity, instead of striving for unity, and you are literally not healthy. You keep on striving simply for things that celebrate your freedom. It's not about your freedom. It's not about your rights. It's about you and I. This you is plural. You to live instead of simply exist. See? A non-healthy organism simply exists. It's not living. If you're just, see, if you're on life support, you're not living life, you're just existing. So he says, live a life which is that is worthy of the calling you have received. Folks, I have so much constraint on my time and so much to tell you, but please listen, if you ever get anything from this morning, almost afternoon with me, get this. The reason why you and I must live a life worthy is not so by you living a life that is worthy brings you or gives you a calling. Look at me. Since you have received a calling, you live a life that is worthy. Tracking? Stop striving on your self-righteousness to get something from God. God has given you everything to live a life that is worthy. Do not make any excuses. See, I'm going to say it again. See, Paul is saying, live a life that is worthy of the calling you have received. So for us, in the context of our church, in the context of who we are, is reflected on a tripod. See, this is why we have a tripod on a stage, because this calling that you have received, this calling that you're supposed to exercise and that you're supposed to live out, this calling that has been misused, misrepresented, or maybe potentially even forgotten, ultimately belongs and begins with a sovereign sovereign, with something beyond your ability, with something that has to do with a God that before eternity he chose, he decided, and that's one of the legs of this, that decided to come into your rescue. This is the God that before he created the heavens and the earth, he has a conversation with the Son and says, I'm going to give you those who will be saved. And you will go and you will die a perfect death. You will live a perfect life and you will not rescue. So the first leg is the calling that comes from God. God has called us. He's calling us right now. He has called you. So if you haven't responded, which is the second leg, look at the second leg, the necessary response. The perfect example is Peter. Peter talking to Jesus, the disciples. Jesus says, who do people say that I am? You are one of the prophets, John the Baptist, maybe Elijah, maybe Jeremiah. And he says, who do you say I am? Peter says, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Jesus replies and says, Peter, because there was no flesh and no blood that revealed this to you, but except my heavenly Father, upon this affirmation, I will build my church. Now, watch this. So who spoke to Peter? God. God revealed to Peter, but Peter had to speak. So which of the two legs is? The answer is yes. So as God saves you, you have to respond in faith. As God calls you, you have to bring a response. Now, the third leg is the one that we're trying to bring into the equation for a healthy organism that actually fulfills the purpose why this exists. Because I'm telling you right now, this tripod will be unnecessary and will become a distraction if it only tries to function in two legs. An unhealthy tripod cannot stay. Right? If you try to put this tripod on one leg, it's going to be pretty pointless. It's even dangerous because this is metal. It can hurt you. So the third leg is literally now the combination of God calling, people responding into Christ likeness. So what does that look like in our context? For us as a church, and this is a beautiful reminder, as a church, we take about 20 plus people to Germany. And this is 2 years ago. I mean, talking about diversity. This is what, three churches all together? I don't know, two or three churches together. Us and a couple other churches from here in Kansas. And anyways, here's the point. You bring a bunch of people that they are just by default diverse. We are just, I mean, diversity is understatement today. We're diverse by nature. But we understand that God has called us to the nation. We understand that we respond, second leg, by giving of our money, giving of our time, giving of our effort, giving of our vacation time. And then by modeling what we preach, now we take this gospel and we see something beautiful portrayed in Germany. Within the next 4 months, a bunch of Germans are going to be here exactly to portray the same thing. So what I'm asking you to do this morning is to think about this trifold experience, this tripod experience, because that's what produces this health. In the context of this health for the life of the church, it's always given in the context of covenants. And I didn't know how to portray this better for you and I, but family life. Because I think family is a covenant. I know you didn't ask to be born in the family you were born. I know. But this is your family. Those are your parents. Yeah, that's your sister. I know. But anyways, here's the point. It's in the context of covenantal relationships that we see a mom and a dad. See, what you see on the screen, on the side is a thermostat. But the thermostat has also a thermometer. And the thermometer exists to read the temperature. I want you to listen to me for a moment. If you're a parent, you've got to listen to this. Stop making the mistake to become the thermometer in the life of your family. You were not created to simply evaluate where your kids are. You were created, even before they were born, to set the temperature. So this thermostat has the ability to read the temperature, which is important, but it's more important that this thermostat sets the temperature. That's why when you look at the screen, you see a distinction, not in essence. See, they both are equally important because in that little gadget that you see on the wall, if the thermometer is not working, this place will just continue to produce air and more cold or heat, whatever the case may be, but it will never stop. Right? So you need a balance between them. In the picture of covenantal relationship for the sake of unity, you need a group of people, in this case mom and dad, that they are the thermostat. They set the temperature for where we are in life as parents. Obviously, unhealthy marriages produces unhealthy children. Now, that's not the case all the time, because I don't have time to give you examples through the Bible that that wasn't the case. In the Bible, you have godly parents with crazy kids, and you have godly children with really crazy parents. So it's not always a set deal, and you and I know if you've been a parent, you know it's not a black and white sometimes, but here's the point. The point is that we are exactly the same, we just have different functions, but in essence, we are exactly the same. So going back to Germany, when you go to Germany, man, you have different calls, people do different things, but we have the same, I mean, without everyone, it's not gonna work out. If you come together, you work together. Now, in our case, as a church, how will that look like? What will be the experience or the process or the understanding of this process? Hey guys, it's not, here we go. Okay, so here's what happens. If we are to be a church that, again, is striving for health, not unity, health, and out of this health produces unity and embraces diversity, this is who we're supposed to be. Let's get to the nitty-gritty, because we're going to pray in just a minute. You're going to have to be, I'm going to have to be completely, huh? Come on. You're going to have to be, I'm going to have to be completely, not partially, not temporarily, not circumstantially, but you have to be completely. In the Bible, there is only two characters that were described as humble. One is Jesus, the other one is Moses. That's a pretty tough standard to follow. Wouldn't you say that? Moses? I'm like, Moses? Moses pastored a complaining church for 40 years. Mercy, that's a long time. Humble? Anyways, gentle, patience, bearing with one another in love. Why? Why do we need to bear with one another? Because God bear with me. Because Romans 5:8 says that when I was still a sinner, what happened? Christ died for my sins. So I have to bear with each other's burdens. Verse 3, make every single effort, intentionality, aggressiveness, to do what? To do what? Here we go. Don't miss this. Here's the effort that we make. See, the effort is not for us to avoid splitting or fighting. The effort is not to avoid divorce. The effort is not that we can potentially bring our children back into the Lord. Listen to me for a second. See, the effort in a collective manner is that we embrace the reality of this tried, full experience. You, I never saw the Lord. The Lord, first leg, the Lord came and saw me. The Lord took the initiative. The Holy Spirit brought conviction into my life. He's doing it this morning right now. It was my job out of the empowerment of the Holy Spirit now to respond to this experience. And now we brought this unity that we're describing, the unity of the Spirit. But now watch this. This is through the bond of peace. Peace is a combination of these two legs coming together to a third leg that based on what God did at the beginning, now He empowers me through this third leg to practice what I have done previously, which is embracing the wholeness of God. Now I am going through life in a godly manner, because my concern is that some of us, when we avoid one of the legs, when we take two of the legs, when we have no legs, we're going to be a church that is literally existing. Marriages that are not producing what they are supposed to produce. And here we are beginning a new stage in the life of this nation, expecting for our government to do this. And households are not modeling this. We are critical towards a nation that is divided, and we have churches that are not experiencing this, taking ownership that our goal, look at me, our goal is not to have unity among ourselves. Our goal is to have unity with the Spirit of God. That's the goal. I like you. I hope and you like me. But that's not the goal for you and I to get along. It's for you and I to understand that the reason why we get along is because of the Spirit of God. See, it is the Spirit of God, the bond of peace, that reminds me that at the end of the journey, everything is about the character of God. Now, folks, if you don't know what the character of God is, it's simply the reversal of what happened prior to the fall. Do I need to explain to you what happened at the fall? Do I need to explain to you that this is the moment when Adam and Eve literally looked at God and said, "Forget you, I'm going to run my own show"? So as you sit in this place, I'm going to invite you to think about the character of God that has been entrusted to us, that the world is going to receive or reject. The world is going to receive or is going to reject either the character of God. Your children are going to embrace or say no to either the character of God, a trifle experience, or a mockery of the character of God, a caricature of the character of God. And it's crazy for to me that it's been entrusted to us. It's crazy that God will entrust me, you know, this imagery. But this is why Paul brings and simply says this: from this reversal of the fall, we must become one body. We must become and understand that there is only one Spirit, and that this Spirit is the one that helps us understand that based on the Spirit of God, there is also one hope. The word hope is the word certainty. What is it that is certain? The certainty of the gospel is that one day the heavens will split wide open, and at the sound of the trumpet, here's a certainty, at the sound of the trumpet, there is no Lamb of God coming back. He already came. Who's coming? He's not coming to forgive the sins of the world. Those are available right now. Forgiveness is available now. He's coming, the Lion of Judah, to do what? To bring judgment over this world. That's what he's coming to. And he's going to judge us based on this experience of the holistic view of the health of the life of the church. That we become literally the standard to the point that we have that certainty because we have been called. And this calling has to do with understanding that as we portray a healthy environment, a healthy system, we must proclaim the gospel that there is only how many lords? How many lords? There's one Lord. We are a monotheistic religion. We believe in one God that is a triune God, but it's one God. See, this one God is produced and is exercised by one faith. It's one single way of life. Whose faith? The faith of Jesus. Not your faith, but the faith of Jesus. And this brings us into a public experience of water baptism. So, one God. Here we go. One God and one Father. He is of everyone that experiences this holistically. This is the one God, one Father, who is over all and is through all and is in every one of us. So today, here's how I want you to close our time with me. You need to understand this morning that this one Father, this one God, is the God that moves us not simply from God, which is the Creator, but Father, which is the Recreator. Some of us, we have settled to simply say, well, yeah, everybody's a child of God. Everybody was created by God. Oh, I come from God. Oh, God is, that's fine, and I'm glad you do that. But what if I told you again that this God thing is relational? It's literally the presence of the God who is moving us into a recreating experience. This is the God that is shaping us into a healthy church. So it's not enough that you see God as creator. You have to see God as a recreator. This is the God that today is bringing us into this reality as we pray as a church. He said, but each one of us. Now see, he moved from a plural context, from a community to a personal level. One of us, each one of us, each one of us, every one of us. What is it? What happened to all of us? Grace. What happened to us? Grace. See, I'm going to say this again. When you strive for health that produces unity and that celebrates diversity, look at me for a second. This is the beauty of the gospel. And I hope you can walk away from this place thinking in those terms. Health, unity, and diversity will be the three pillars, the three experiences that will remind you constantly. The grace was given to you. Because the more that you are reminded and you experience and you see the grace of God given to you, the more that you're going to give it away. The less grace that you are given. By the way, what is the opposite of grace? What is the opposite of being gracious? Anybody? Legalism, judgmental mindset. See, the more that you understand that you were given grace, apparently these churches have forgotten that this whole conversation began with grace. Apparently, people, we have a tendency to, instead of focusing that one day God the Father, and based on Romans chapter 5 verse 8, when I was still a sinner, Christ died for us. See, we keep on forgetting that the Father gave us grace by giving His very own Son. And Paul is reminding us this morning that the moment that you disregard grace, the moment that you forget that grace is simply a person. Please look at me for a second. We're going to talk about this for the next 3 Sundays. And my heart's desire is not that we walk in unity. My heart's desire is not that we become healthy. My heart's desire is not that we celebrate each other instead of getting into each other's nerves. My heart's desire is that we see grace as the person of Jesus. So I want you to hear this from me. The win is not a united church. The win is not a church that is healthy. The win is not a church that is diverse. The win is Jesus. Jesus is the win. Stop thinking that what we need is just a better church, a more united, a less conflict. Stop thinking that we just need things to improve. If we can just go back to where I used to be instead of, see, please listen to me. What has departed from churches who are not united, churches who do not embrace health, churches who do not embrace diversity, is the presence of God. That's what is missing. It's Jesus, it's grace being portrayed not only as a doctrine, but as a person. It's the person of Jesus. That now, since Jesus has been given to us, we allow Jesus to apportion this calling, this grace, this gift, this understanding. This morning, I want you to understand that we are simply fellow co-laborers. He is in charge. He is the God of our creation. So for some of you who want to fill up all the blanks, here's the bottom line. We embrace the gift of Jesus, and we embrace the fruits of Jesus. It is His personality, and it is His calling or ministry. That's what we do in this place. And I promise you, until we see these gifts of the Spirit, not your gifts, look at me, not your gifts. You see, I'm just afraid that if we do not embrace the person of Jesus once again, we're going to embrace our own giftedness. And you and I, we're going to argue why I have to do what I'm called to do. You're going to argue, just like Paul. Remember Paul, Saul of Tarsus, chapter 9 of the book of Acts? He's on the road to Damascus with the right proper, you know, letters to do what he thought he was right. I'm all for you being right. I'm so glad you're passionate for Jesus. I love your resilience. I love the fact that you're still here. But listen to me for a moment. We need grace portrayed not simply as a concept, but as a person. That person is Jesus of Nazareth.